Edward Harrison Leslie was born April 21st, 1957 in Tampa, Florida, and began his professional wrestling career in 1977. Between 1977 and 2015, he had a very successful career because of one gimmick, Brutus the Barber Beefcake. However, besides being the barber, Ed Leslie's remembered as a wrestler who, let's just say, has had a ton of personas over the years. After a while, it became kind of an inside running joke on just how many different gimmicks he's had over the years. So this week, I'm going to be covering all the different gimmicks of one Brutus Edward Brute Baron Dizzy, the Booty Brother Barber Butcher Clipmaster Disciple Mariner Zodiac, Boulder Golden Hogan Force Brute Beefcake, who ironically enough has the alias The Man With No Name. Don't forget to like this episode, leave a comment in the comment section below, subscribe to the channel if you haven't already, click the notification bell to be notified when a new episode is live, follow me on all my social media platforms, Twitter, Facebook, and Instagram, watch all prior episodes in the archive, most importantly of all, enjoy the episode. Now, for the first few years of his professional wrestling career, Ed Leslie was portrayed as Terry Bolea's little brother in Bolea's various different gimmicks. Bolea was Terry Boulder, so Leslie was Ed Boulder, also at times named Eddie Boulder. Bolea became Sterling Golden, so Leslie became Ed Golden, also at times named Eddie Golden. Then Leslie went from Eddie Golden to Dizzy Golden. Bolea eventually became his most iconic gimmick Hulk Hogan, so Leslie became Ed Hogan, also at times named Eddie Hogan, then Leslie went from Eddie Hogan to Dizzy Hogan. Now, during these first few years of his career over these various different gimmicks, Ed Leslie would wrestle a ton of different places in the United States. The CWA in Memphis, Mid-South, did some WWF matches before his Beefcake persona, the AWA, Pacific Northwest, aka Portland, Mid-Atlantic, Southeastern, aka Alabama, saw moderate success at best early on, would be Dizzy Hogan the longest out of all his early gimmicks, but would bounce his personas depending where he was in the country. He would win a few territory belts here and there, but that was about it early on. Most people probably don't know this, hell, even I didn't know about this until doing research for this episode, but Ed Leslie actually wrestled as himself, Ed Leslie, whenever he went to New Japan Pro Wrestling and did some tours over there. He did a few tours between 1982 and 1984. He would only be there for about a month per tour over there. He would wrestle against Hulk during some of these tours. In 82, he wrestled him a ton in tag matches, six-man tag matches, even some one-on-one matches against the Hulkster, but he would lose every single time against Brother Do Brother. In April 1983, he would team with Paul Orndorff a ton on this tour. In late August, early September 83, he went back and did some various stuff there. And in March 1984, he would go back and do some more stuff over there as well. In between tours of Japan, Ed Leslie had very brief runs under the names Brute Force and Baron Beefcake. Eventually, Ed Leslie would begin his proper run in the World Wrestling Federation as his first non-Hogan little brother gimmick that wasn't Brute Force or Baron Beefcake. This one was Brutus Beefcake. He was portrayed as a vain male stripper managed by Johnny V, even teamed with Johnny a few times. Brutus would challenge World Wrestling Federation champion Hulk Hogan many times from late 1984 until the spring of 1985, but it was after his run against Hogan that started the first real kayfabe success for him in his career. Brutus Beefcake would team up with former Intercontinental champion Greg Valentine to form the Dream Team. Would still get the occasional singles title shot here and there, but now it was tag competition for Beefcake. In August 1985, the Dream Team knocked off the US Express to become the new World Wrestling Federation Tag Team Champions. They would have a run for 226 days and would have many successful defenses in rematches against the US Express. They would defend against many other teams all over the WWF in title defenses. Then the feud with the British Bulldogs began late in 1985. The Bulldogs had many chances against the Dream Team, but would either lose against them or defeat them by disqualification or countout. Regardless of the result, the Dream Team escaped every single time with the Tag Team Championships. WrestleMania 2 would be the Bulldogs' last chance at the Dream Team. There, the Bulldogs would succeed, defeating the Dream Team to become the new Tag Team Champions. Dream Team would chase the Bulldogs throughout the rest of 1986, but were never able to recapture the Tag Team Championships. At WrestleMania 3 in the undercard, the Dream Team defeated the Rougeaus in a tag team match. But not only was there a new member to the Dream Team in Dino Bravo, but after the match, after an argument, Valentine, Bravo, and Johnny V left Beefcake high and dry. This would begin what ended up being his most famous gimmick, as later on at WrestleMania 3, Beefcake would assist Piper in the cutting of the hair of Adrian Adonis, which was revenge for what Adonis did to Beefcake prior to WrestleMania 3 when Adonis accidentally cut some of Beefcake's hair off. And with that, Brutus the Barber Beefcake was born. However, according to Ed Leslie himself, he was not the biggest fan of this change in persona. He thought that becoming the barber was going to be the end of his career. It's like, he's going from a vain male stripper heel to a barber babyface? This ain't going to work at all. But him becoming the barber, it was the gimmick that ended up becoming the gimmick what people remember him for the most. They ran the vignette of him learning how to properly cut hair. He started off coming out with the barber coat, with the regular scissors, but then he started coming out to these wacky outfits, the famous edge clippers. He put his opponents in the sleeper hold, knocked them out, cut their hair, wait for them to get up, show them in the mirror. They go nuts every single time, and this got over as time went on, more over than what anyone ever thought it would. He had his run against Johnny V on the house shows, as well as against the new Dream Team. Slowly as time went on, Brutus the Barber Beefcake became one of the most over World Wrestling Federation babyfaces. After a run against Greg Valentine in one-on-one matches on the house shows, Beefcake began his next big program. World Wrestling Federation Intercontinental Champion the Honky Tonk Man, he needed a new face to be his challenger, and Brutus was it. Now, after the stunt the Honky Tonk Man pulled with the main event, I'm surprised he wasn't forced to drop the IC title at WrestleMania 4, but alas, it was decided that Brutus would be chasing Honky for most of 1988, only defeating him at WrestleMania 4 by disqualification. All the way through mid-August, it was Brutus, Honky Tonk Man, all over the house shows. It was announced that at SummerSlam, it would be Beefcake's last chance at the Intercontinental Championship. However, after, according to Ed Leslie himself, Warrior said something to the powers that be in the WWF, and that put Warrior in the spot over Beefcake at SummerSlam. Instead, they would write Beefcake out of SummerSlam after Ron Bass cut him with the spur on television. That led to a series of matches with them, leading to a hair match on Saturday night's main event. After another run against Greg Valentine and a WrestleMania 5 match against Ted DiBiase, Brutus Beefcake would take part in a big role in the company, as he would be inserted into the Hulk Hogan-Randy Savage feud, teaming with his shoot friend Hulk Hogan. Beefcake would feud with Savage on the house shows, even beating him on some of those. Beefcake and Hogan would defeat Savage and Zeus at SummerSlam in a tag team match, as well as at the No Holds Barred, the movie, the match, in a steel cage match. In the middle of his tag team with Hulk Hogan and feuding with Randy Savage, Beefcake did matches with Rick Martel on the house shows, as well as Mr. Perfect. When Hogan started feuding with Perfect, Beefcake was there with him, facing Perfect's manager, the Genius, at Royal Rumble 1990. That ended in a double disqualification, and after Perfect's involvement as well as the Hogan-Perfect feud being over, it was time for Beefcake Perfect. After the house show run against Martel was done, Beefcake would work with Perfect at WrestleMania 6, claiming that nobody is perfect, everyone has flaws, and he'll show Mr. Perfect's flaws, and he will end his undefeated streak in the process, which ended up happening as Brutus Beefcake ended Mr. Perfect's on-screen undefeated streak at WrestleMania 6. This was done for the sole reason of when Perfect wins the vacant Intercontinental Championship after WrestleMania, Beefcake is the natural first opponent for him. If Beefcake could beat him once, he could beat him again, this time for the belt. Beefcake would be in the tournament for the vacant belt, but him and Dino Bravo ended in a double countout. Perfect did win the tournament to become the new champion, and after a run with the Genius, it was Beefcake versus Perfect on the house shows from June 1st through July 1st, 1990, and this was all leading towards a big match between the two for the Intercontinental Championship at SummerSlam 1990, with Beefcake dethroning Perfect to become the new champion. But as plans will be, plans can go awry. On July 4th, 1990, Ed Leslie's life was altered forever when he was involved in a parasailing accident. The result of the accident, his face was crushed. Over 100 feet of wire, 8 plates, and 32 screws were used to build a brand new face. Wrestling was the last thing on anybody's mind. This accident almost killed him, no joke. He needed someone to pry his mouth open so he could breathe, otherwise he would have been dead. The surgery on his face took many, many, many hours, and it cost a whole lot of money. But thank God he had a Screen Actors Guild card, otherwise he'd probably still be in debt to this very day. But after hours of surgery, his face was put back together, and it took a very long time for him to recover, but he was able to recover to just live a normal life. Wrestling was not going to be in the picture for a while, because there was always that concern that if he comes back too soon, takes one false move, his face would be damaged once again. So in the interim, Beefcake did some non-wrestling roles, and it all started in the spring of 1991 when he portrayed a new, unnamed persona. It was this masked man who later people have called the Mariner. He would show up randomly, he would attack random heels, notably Rick Martel, Dino Bravo, and Earthquake. He showed up, threw some punches, gave a headbutt, then he left. This time as the Mariner did not last long at all, and no mention of it was ever brought up again after he just disappeared. After the very brief run as the Masked Mariner, Brutus Beefcake would return to WWF television as the Barber in May of 1991. While he still couldn't wrestle, he could talk, so they gave him his own talk show, The Barber Shop. This would last from May of 1991 until early 1992, and while it wasn't as memorable as other wrestling talk shows over the years, it did still have its moments. One of the very early episodes of The Barber Shop had Roddy Piper as the guest. Piper brought up the parasailing accident. Then he weaved it into his feud with DiBiase, saying money can't buy what Beefcake has, and that's heart. And everything Piper was saying, you could tell Beefcake was legit touched by what he was saying, because you could see him holding back tears. Then, probably the most famous barbershop episode, as well as one of the most famous wrestling talk show episodes ever, January 1992, The Rockers, Sean throws Marty through the window, the rest is history. After the barbershop ended, we really didn't see much of Brutus Beefcake until February 1993. On the February 1st episode of Raw, Beefcake came back. He announced that he's returning to the ring after 2.5 years away from it. He had his first match with Ted DiBiase 2 weeks later. That led to the angle where DiBiase and IRS took a briefcase to his face. That led to Jimmy Hart turning babyface and the return of Hulk Hogan to the WWF. Hogan and Beefcake reformed their team, now known as the Mega Maniacs. They went after Money Incorporated and the WWF Tag Team Championships at WrestleMania 9. During this period, Beefcake would wear a protective face mask. The Mega Maniacs failed to win the Tag Team Championships at that event and subsequent attempts on house shows afterwards, After the European tour in August 1993, Brutus Beefcake left the World Wrestling Federation after 9 years with them. When Hulk Hogan went to World Championship Wrestling in 1994, Ed Leslie was not far behind, although he could no longer be Brutus Beefcake or be known as the Barber. So in WCW, when he came in, he would be known as the Clipmaster, and his name would be Brother Bruti. Clipmaster is the legal distinct difference way that he could be called the Barber without being called the Barber, and Bruti being a nickname he was given by commentators during his time in the WWF. He wouldn't have a match as Brother Bruti in WCW, he would just be in Hogan's corner, but when they couldn't get anybody to be the mysterious masked man, they decided to put Bruti under the mask. It was revealed to be him at Halloween Havoc 1994 after the cage match. Bobby Heenan said that Bruti butchered a friendship, which gave him a brand new name, The Butcher. Butcher, along with Kevin Sullivan and Avalanche, formed the Three Faces of Fear, and their goal was to stop Hulk Hogan and Hulkamania. Being shoot best friends with the Hulkster did have its benefits, because at Starrcade 1994, in the main event, for the World Heavyweight Championship, it was Hulk Hogan versus The Butcher. Of course, Hogan won to retain the belt, and the two sides would continue feuding into 1995. Eventually, as 1995 went on, Ed Leslie could no longer be The Butcher, as according to Kevin Sullivan, Abdullah The Butcher sued WCW for $100,000 over the name The Butcher, as he had been known as The Butcher for 30 years up to that point. So when the Three Faces of Fear broke up in the spring of 1995, The Butcher was no more, and in its place was the amnesiac known as The Man With No Name. Though very briefly beforehand, he was known as The Man With No Face, even though you could see his face, so he did have a face. And as far as The Man With No Name goes, that is his name, therefore The Man With No Name makes no sense, but whatever. As The Man With No Name, he did have a pay-per-view match with Kevin Sullivan at Slamboree 1995, a loss. The Man With No Name lasted even shorter than Brother Bruti and The Butcher, as then when they were forming the Dungeon of Doom, he was put into that group, now known as the repackaged face-painted Zodiac. From the land of yin and yang, he would only say yes and no. He got to main event War Games at Fall Brawl 1995 against Hogan and the Hulkamaniacs in a losing effort. The Zodiac lasted until the end of 1995, until being repackaged in early 1996 as the Booty Man. Hulk Hogan had Zodiac join Dungeon of Doom as a double agent. He was with Hogan all along. Now he was known as the Booty Man, nicknamed Big Brother Booty. He was the PG version of Mr. Ass with his finisher, the High Knee, a play on Heine, get it? His ass! When Johnny B. Badd left WCW, Booty Man got Kimberly as his manager, calling her the Booty Babe. As Booty Man, he would defeat lower card talent. He lost to anybody of any significance, though he did get a DQ victory over United States heavyweight champion Ric Flair on an episode of Nitro. When the New World Order formed, Booty Man tried to be the fourth member of the group, even getting Hogan a cake for his birthday, only for Hogan and the Outsiders to beat him up to prove a point. If Hogan can do that to his best friend, what will he do to Ric Flair and the rest of WCW? After some house show matches in late 1996, Ed Leslie disappeared from WCW for over a year, returning in early 1998 as the unrecognizable Disciple, the bodyguard of Hollywood Hogan in the NWO. Unless you were a smart mark at this time, you had no clue it was Beefcake until a promo on Nitro in the build-up for Spring Stampede when Roddy Piper revealed who the Disciple was. Quote, formerly Brutus Beefcake, formerly the Zodiac, formerly the Booty Man. You know what his real name is? E. Harrison Leslie. And then you go and look at him and like, oh shit, it is Beefcake. He looks way different. he got into the best shape of his entire career during this run as the Disciple. He rarely wrestled. He was mostly Hogan's muscle during this time. That came to an end during the feud between Hogan and Warrior. Warrior kidnapped Disciple, brainwashed him, and Disciple became the second member of the One Warrior Nation. And then Warrior left WCW, and that left Disciple with nothing. He stayed around WCW for another year, wrestling on the C shows, occasionally the A and B shows. Scott Hudson on the C shows on commentary would make references to all the different names Beefcake's been going through over the years, combining all of them into one giant name. Later on in his run, Disciple would start dressing up as he did during his days as the Barber. His final match in WCW was in November 1999 against Jim Duggan on an episode of Worldwide. He would do a lot of indies in the years after his WCW run, even dusting off Brute Force for iGeneration Superstars of Wrestling, but he mostly used the Brutus Beefcake name, as that is what people know him for. He had his final match in November 2015, and in April 2019, Brutus the Barber Beefcake was inducted into the WWE Hall of Fame. So to recap, Ed Leslie over the years has been known as Eddie Ed Boulder, Eddie Ed Golden, Dizzy Golden, Eddie Ed Hogan, Dizzy Hogan, Ed Leslie, Brute Force, Baron Beefcake, Brutus Beefcake, Brutus the Barber Beefcake, The Mariner, The Clipmaster Brother Bruti, The Butcher, The Man with No Face, The Man with No Name, Zodiac, The Booty Man, and The Disciple. 18 different gimmicks that spanned a 38-year career, or a new gimmick every little over 2 years. But even with all those different gimmicks over the years, what people remember him for is what started in 1984 when he started his proper run in the WWF, Brutus Beefcake. Specifically, what started in 1987, Brutus the Barber Beefcake. Going back earlier to when I said he thought that the Barber would be the end of his career, ironically enough, it's the gimmick that made him into a Hall of Famer. I know people poke fun at all his gimmicks and his association with Hogan over the years, but there was a time where Beefcake was one of the most over babyfaces in the World Wrestling Federation. During that era, when the WWF had a ton of over babyfaces, Brutus Beefcake was one of them. Hell, you say to an old school wrestling fan, name 15 memorable WWF characters during the 80s, I bet you Brutus the Barber Beefcake gets brought up more times than not. But those are just my thoughts. What do you guys think? Share your thoughts on all the faces of Brutus Beefcake in the comments section below. Ask questions about Beefcake and all his different gimmicks, and I'll answer them. What are your favorite and least favorite Beefcake gimmicks, matches, and moments? And the question of the week, what is your Mount Rushmore of Brutus Beefcake gimmicks? Gotta pick 4 of them. Don't forget to like, comment, share, subscribe, click the bell, and follow me on social media. Until next time, peace.
It's the interview queen, Alicia Tu, and I would like to introduce you all to From the Vault, a weekly wrestling discussion hosted by James over on We Are Pro Wrestling on YouTube. Since 2017, From the Vault has covered various wrestling topics from the past, like pay-per-views, wrestler retrospectives, and much, much more.